Well, the heart of a SPARROW model is really is the in-stream water quality data that's been collected over years and years. Generally, we need at least 10 years of monitoring data, say quarterly monitoring data at different sites. And we might need 100 sites throughout the area that we want to model. So that's really the beginning of the SPARROW modeling process. We begin with a set of estimates of in-stream load at long-term monitoring stations. And then we assemble a set of what we call ancillary data, data that is spatial, geographic data, that, for example, data on factors that we believe are sources of nutrients, such as atmospheric deposition is a source of nitrogen, fertilizer use or livestock manure production in a watershed, urban land areas. So that's the those are the sources of nutrients. And then we also need to assemble a set of data, geographic data, that describe the spatial distribution of factors such as soil permeability, rainfall rates, soil pH, factors, really physical watershed characteristics that we believe are controlling the rate at which nutrients move from wherever they're placed in a watershed towards the stream. And then finally, we also need to assemble ancillary data about channel characteristics, channel hydraulics, such as velocity, time of travel, reservoir characteristics that affect the rate at which nutrients move in stream towards some receiving water body.
Well, I think that's important in the process of setting up a SPARROW model, having a framework of sorts to help assemble the players, I guess, the dancers, if you will, in this party, the source variables and the transport variables. As you know, in our case, for the Southeast phosphorus model, we use the phosphorus index, which was a pretty, you know, it's an accumulation of variables that is based on experimental data. And I think that's one of the strengths of SPARROW, the ability of SPARROW to upscale some information that is derived at a small field scale or flat scale. So having a framework that helps you decide what variables to test, I think, would be the next step in setting up a SPARROW model. And hopefully one would have all the data sets one would need. I think that other very important step, and it's one that you brought out and taught me, is to test source variables first in a source-only model, because one would assume the source variables really have a pretty strong signature on in-stream loads. And then add your transport variables and test them individually for significance. Significance level, I'm sorry. I forgot what it was that we did. Test the variables for significance and for independence, and also making sure that as you get more information into the model, you're not creating too much information such that you have a overly redundant model, because ultimately the goal is to achieve the most parsimonious model that explains as much load variability as possible. And finally, add transport factors to fully complete the picture of transport from upstream to downstream receiving water bodies. Once you have that, and you have I think, well, I don't know what would a good number be. Once you have explained at least over 50% of your observed low variability, I think you have a working model.
I think another factor that comes in when, as you're building a model, as you're deciding between variables, for example, you might have two variables that seem to work equally well.
Clay content in the soil and organic matter both worked almost as well in the phosphorus model.
And why did you pick one over the other?
There was a slight improvement. You know, organic matter was a little better than soil clay content. And clay content was more collinear with another term, and I think that was pH. So in order to retain those two, in order to retain pH, I would have to hold on to organic matter. That's so geeky. I am sorry.
What I was thinking of was, this really helps make it more clear to people familiar with other types of watershed models how different the SPARROW process is. This idea that we're, you know, picking this variable up and plugging it in, seeing how it works. Oh, we don't like that one. We'll get rid of that.
Yeah,
let's
that sounds
pick another
hokey.
One in. No, I don't think it sounds hokey. I think it does. It sounds like you are letting the data, you are putting the data in the driver's seat, and you as the modeler are informing it with what you understand about the process, but you're letting the data tell you what the set of driver variables should be.
Yeah, I think that's true, but there is a danger when you don't truly know what the process is and you're sort of in the dark a little bit about a specific variable. What process does it represent? And
I don't know. I think there's something to be said for approaching it from that angle and seeing how close you get to, for example, some of the literature values of coefficients for those terms or for similar terms. You know, the idea that you can march at it from a totally different direction and converge. I mean, for one thing, that gives us a lot more confidence of about those other types of watershed models.
Right.
One of the many comparisons that you can make from SPARROW to the deterministic models. But what I was thinking about was another type of choice that we can make is whether or not, how useful a variable might be for some application of the model. And that's why it's important for us to understand what managers and regulators are really faced with trying to manage. So, for example, if you know, you may have a model that's working great just using land cover types, you know, urban cover versus forest cover versus agricultural cover, and that model might be just as good as some of the models that are based on actual mass terms, estimates of fertilizer use or livestock production,
right,
or background sources of a constituent. But that land cover-based model is not going to meet certain types of applications. It wouldn't be relevant to a manager who's saying, well, if we cut back on livestock production, or if, you know, if we were looking at say BMPs that would address livestock production by 50%, what effect would that have on nitrogen export from a watershed?
Right.
Then you would want to use those types of variables.
You could have a model, a SPARROW model, that is specified differently depending on the management question. That's one thing that is going on right now. The national model is a land cover model, and regional models are mostly mass models. Actually, yesterday at the presentation at NC State, that was a question that I got. Why are all our terms not land use terms? That way we could compare across export rates. And you could look from the coefficients, just how do how do the export coefficients compare against each other and how they parse out. That, you know, certain people are interested in that specific number. So we could have, you know, differently specified SPARROW models for the same region. But it's just information that depends on that management question.